Mr. Ram Kumar?
Yes, sir. Good evening.
Very good evening, sir.
I will start. Start another 2 minutes.
No problem. We can start. Poonam madam? Poonam madam?
Should we start?
Yeah, we'll
I think
start.
Most of the people, they had already came into our webinar. Good evening, everybody. First of all, I welcome you. And I think about CC, you will give the Ram Kumar ji.
Yeah, I'll give. Welcome to this BAD webinar series, and welcome to this webinar session. And about CCC, let me introduce myself. I am Ram Kumar, Vice President of CCC, and a Management System Consultant. And about CCC Consultants Consortium of Chennai is an association of management system consultants registered under the Tamil Nadu Societies Registration Act 1975. So the key objective of CCC is to work in alignment with the National Quality Mission launched by the Government of India by educating the industry about the role and importance of standards, certifications and regulations in the country as well as in the global markets. CCC strives to encourage responsible consulting through members of its association, and focus is to standardize consulting practices in alignment with changing market and industry needs in a dynamic manner. The focus is also to identify areas and industries in which the consultants in the profession of management system consulting can contribute to the betterment of the society and the country, and to promote management systems consulting in such areas or industries. One of the core objectives is to collaborate. One of the core objectives is to collaborate with various industry platforms, trade associations, chamber of commerce, management associations, apex bodies of government or quasi-government organizations to contribute to the betterment of the industry and initiatives, which will in turn contribute to the betterment of the society. Next slide, please. About BAD, World Accreditation Day is a global initiative established by ILAC and IAF. This year's theme is how accreditation improves food safety. Accreditation has an important role in food safety by ensuring competent and impartial inspection, certification and testing services in all parts of local, national and international food chains. In doing so, accreditation supports the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, that is SDGs, in particular the Good Health and Well-being Goal, that is SDG3. Accreditation can be applied to a wide variety of assessment, approval or evaluation tasks, and is used by business, government and regulators to help deliver a safer world. So now I request Sri Alok Jain ji, who is with us, to tell about TCB.
Good evening. Thank you very much. Good evening. This is Alok Jain. I am the director and the head of Training and Capacity Building Division of Quality Council of India. As mentioned, 9th June is marked as the World Accreditation Day. And this year focus is on improving the food safety. Appreciating the efforts made by Consultant Consortium of Chennai to celebrate BAD in a unique way. And they are now having series of webinars. Today is the 9th webinar in the series. I thank you. I thank the consortium to give an opportunity to introduce this new division of Quality Council of India. As you know, QCIE is having a lot of five boards. One is NABCB, giving accreditation to certification bodies and inspection bodies. Then we have NABL for granting accreditation to the laboratories, NABH for hospital accreditations, NABED for in the education sector, and NBQP is for the quality promotion. There is a new division created called Training and Capacity Building Division under the ambit of Quality Council of India. And our role is to provide the training in various domains, right from quality management, food safety, project management, food industry, healthcare sectors, environment, education. So we are working closely with the associations, and this is the first step that we are working with closely with the Consultant Consortium of Chennai to expand our activities. Thank you very much for giving an opportunity.
Thank you, Alok ji. Thank you for that introduction about TCB. Now I request today's presenter for this webinar is Ms. Poonam Gupta, and the co-presenter is Shri V. Prem Kumar. And I welcome both of them for this webinar number 9. Now I am handing over the session to the presenter, today's presenter, Poonam Gupta ji. Over to you.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Mr. Ramkumar and Dr. Alok. You people have given us the opportunity to give us this opportunity. So first of all, I will introduce myself. Basically, myself Poonam Gupta. I belong to North India, near about my native place is Ambala. You can say because most of the people they doesn't know about my place. That is in Ambala. It's nearby Chandigarh. Basically, I am a lead auditor for QMS, EMS, FSMS, and I am also FSSAI authorized consultant, which has inaugurated on 16th October 2019 by Dr. Harshvardhan Sharma. And I am also foster trainer in different sector like milk and nutraceutical, advanced manufacturing. And I did so many training sessions to in various industry and with the government also. And I am also running my unit which is dealing in Ayurveda, nutraceutical and animal feed supplements. Right now, I am doing animal feed supplement export to Afghanistan and Nepal. So out of my preview, it's my personal point of view. So today I want to deliver as much as I can. Now I will request to Mr. Prem Kumar, he will give you the introduction.
Very good evening to all. I am Prem Kumar. I'm the NPQP registered principal consultant for MSMS, and I'm the managing director of the company called Javin Management Systems and Solutions Private Limited. I'm 16 years of industrial experience in management system consultant implementation. We across automotive, engineering, construction, and we got diversified into food and feed industries. I'm the qualified BRCGS auditor for food and packaging and FSSAI 20,000. We across more than 100 organizations for these food safety system implementation activities. We're from South India, Chennai. We have office in Dubai and Muscat, Oman. We are having a lot of international assignments. We are specialized and performing more in process excellence activities. In this session, I'm the co-presenter. I'm helping Poonam Gupta for her presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Prem Kumarji. Basically, today our chapter is that is export market requirement for Europe, USA, UAE, and Australia. We are covering this all aspect. So first of all, we should understand what is export. Exports are the goods and services produced in one country and purchased by a resident of another country. Like if I am, we are growing the rice and any food product. And suppose any Australian company, they wanted to this rice. So then I am a consigner and they are a consignee, right? So this is export. This is called export from one country to another country. If it is produced domestically and sold to someone in a foreign country, it is called export. This is definition. And because on geographically angle, we are divided into the countries part. So every country, they have their own regulation also. But the basic, what are the basic thing which we required? Today we will discuss, and later on we can also discuss country-wise also, what are the basic requirements for any country, whether it is UAE, if we talk about Australia, if we talked about the Europe. These are the few basic things which is required for anything export to any country. First of all, I will suggest ki these are the document required before dispatch. Because if I got some customer, so first of all, I need some export license for the export, for exporting my product. I need that is export license. We call as a import export code. That is later on we will share all the thing. Then we need MOU, that is a mutual of understanding. Then we need for the pro forma invoice. And after that, we have to LC. You can say that can be named as a bank guarantee. And after that, certificate of origin. And which is requirement is a dossier. That is in case of any novel product in the nutraceutical. We are not talking about any, because food is a wide range. Food, you can say that is a grains, that is a processed food. And that is also nutraceutical. But for any novel product in nutraceutical, we need the dossier also. because before export, if we finalize the customer, so they need also dossier in particular novel food and nutraceutical, what is the shelf. In dossier, we have to given them the all ingredient list, what are the additives, and which pharmacopoeia we are focusing in, on which codex law we are focusing on that. These all requirement before dispatch, because we have to send to the export agency. And at the time of dispatch, we need the commercial invoice and insurance certificate and export packaging list. That is a must. And after dispatch, when we are dispatch the goods, and when our products are being landed on the port, so then there is bill of landing. For bill of landing, we need some clearance agent. We called as a CHA, those who are working, they will give us all the documents to the our import and export officers, and they will clear they will help us for clearing the shipments. First of all, I will explain the export license. An export license is a government document which is provided by DGFT. That is for every state. Like if we talk about in Haryana, so that DGFT office in Panipat. If we talk about the Punjab, so their DGFT office in Chandigarh. So there are the different state. They have a different office. That is basically DGFT is a central office, central government office, like MSME. So we need that also. And some of the area, if we want to export something, sometime we need also a few things from FSSAI, ki whether we are eligible to send the products or not, even sometime quality controls. And sometime we have a special agreement between two countries, like in Afghanistan, if we are importing, exporting anything, so they are called as our friend country. So they require lesser of the documents. But for the other, like if you called Europe, if we want to send our product in USA and Europe, so then definitely we have to compliance in their country's regulations also. Basically, IEC is a 10-digit code that a business or a person need to import or export goods services. Basically, IEC given to the company name. If you are proprietorship company, so only I can take only one IEC code upon my company name. I will explain how. Like my company name is Dr. Life Sciences, and I have IEC code. And next year I will also establish one new unit, and their proprietor is again Poonam Gupta, right? So they will not give me the same IEC code for my name, ki whether I have to destruct the previous one or I should add this one. So it means for the one proprietor, our DGFT, they will issue only one IEC code. But otherwise, if we have a proprietorship, if we have a partnership company, and if we have some private limited company, so then they will give a certain undefined IEC code number, because basically proprietorship is an ownership company, you can say. So it means if I am running one unit, so I cannot apply for my second, which is again proprietorship company. If I want to export other thing also, so then I need different IEC code. Then I have to establish a different partnership company or private limited company. This code is issued by DGFT, which is called as a Director General of Foreign Trade, and that is a purely online system. And this validity of IEC for long lifetime, there is no need to renew it, because in other certification, you can see they have some certain shelf life and they have some validity time, but in IEC that is a lifetime opportunity. And you can see also on IEC if I have a proprietorship company, so my photograph is also on that IEC licenses. The other name of the IEC code, import export code, import export code, importer export license, importer exporter number. Anybody can name out this IEC code. Basically, that is a document which is a 10 digit code number for a business, unique business. These are the few common documents which I had earlier explained. That is a commercial invoice. A commercial invoice is a bill for the goods, the seller to the buyer. So basically, we need this commercial invoice, because without this commercial invoice, we cannot send our products to other countries. And along with that, we also need some export packing list. What are the in packing list, we have to describe each and everything, which is the seller, who is the buyers, who are the shipper, what is the invoice number, date of shipment, mode of transport, carrier and intimization, drums, carton, the quantity of the packaging, how many pieces, what is the gross weight, and some packaging mark. If we are sending some vegetarian product, then we have to symbolize the green. And if we are exporting some products, egg make, then there is a symbol of brown. And if we are sending some non-veg product, then their symbol is red one, right? These are the two things in export packaging list. We have to describe each and everything. And one is a great thing, that is a performer invoice, because for giving the performer invoice, that we have to submit to our buyer. Basically, that invoice where we had finalized the deal, what is the cost. Basically, that reflect the information of the buyer of the good to be sent, their value, and other specified specifications, product specification. We have to, you as called it, that is a sale or price quotation also. That is also required in performer invoice. And that is a electronic export information filing formally. This is for if we need our shipment is more than $2,500. For that, we required this EEI. But other thing also we needed, later on I will discuss. Then again, we have to air bill and shipment bill. Air freight shipment, if we are sending our product through air, then air freight shipment. And if we are sending our product through shipment, then be called as a shipment bill. And bill of lending is that thing. A bill of lending is a contract between the owner of the good and the carrier as a domestic shipment. And this is generated by, bill of lending is generated by CHC. Because when our goods goes to the port or any transit and transit stage, then only our CHA will generate the bill of lending. This is a temporary certificate, the certificate for the shipment for specific goods. One is a shipment certificate, and this we can say it's a ATA carnet. And ATA carnet, like merchandise passport, you can say if we have to go from one country to another country, we need the passport. The same like if we want to send our products from our India to any foreign country, then we have need the passport, and this is called a merchandise passport. It's a document that facilitates the temporary importation of product into foreign countries by eliminating traffic and value-added any taxation services. If any VAT is imposing on that, so only that is all thing we have to put on that certificate. And then one of the major document, that is a certificate of analysis. A certificate analysis can be required for seed, grains, health food products, dietary supplements, fruit and vegetable, or any pharmaceutical products. Basically, the certificate of analysis that will ensure you what the quality and what inspection criteria we had followed, even though sometimes they are asking for our testing plans also. And like for if we want to export our products to USA, then now they wanted for the this you can say organic products, because they are very in high demand. They don't want, our product is chemically processed. Now in the USA, they are typical for the this organic products. And one product is, that is a certificate of free sale. Certificate of free sale may be issued by biological, food, drug, medical devices and veterinary medicine. More information is available from the Food and Drug Administration. Even FSSAI, our health authorities, or our local authorities, they are also send us the free sale certificate in some area, in some food, some food products. Also our CHA, they are providing us to from the free sale certificate from any health authorities, because there are different things. If we want to some nutraceutical products, then we have sometime we have to require from FDA. And if we want to other grains, then we need for the our health authorities. That can be again very, and that is also required from our from importer. Sometime few requirements we are getting from the importers. If we are submitting some dangerous things, like for sanitation, the thing now we are in COVID, and all our world we are basically facing this type of problem. So then suppose we are exporting some sodium hypochlorite, like I'm talking about, if I am sending to the Malaysia, and if I'm sending to the Thailand, so then we have to put, this is a dangerous goods certificate we have to provide. Basically without this certificate we cannot send that. And for the fishery certificate, that if we are exporting our fish type products we are sending, so then the National Marine Fisheries Service is conducting inspection and analysis of fishery commodity for export the fishery, anything fishery related products, then we have to taken permission from the National Marine Fishery, which they are given the certificate for all these products. Because as you know, USA and the Europe, they wanted, and even Australia, because if we talk about the Europe and Australia, I think most of the things are similar, because whatever the Europe required, Australia, they are just follow that things. So they also need the fumigation certificate. When we are packed our product, after that we have to fumigate that whole container and this whole packets. This period is maximum of 15 days prior to loading, because not more than, we cannot do 30 days before prior of the loading. It should be the fumigation certificate is basically generated by the fumigation. There are certain agencies, even those who are that type of company, like pest control companies, they also do some fumigation, because they have a certain methodology, and they are also approving by the government of India for export the food product. We need also fumigation certificate. Like if we want our product sent to the UAE, then they needed the halal certification, which is required for the meat and poultry products. Even sometime they also need for the some grains and the rice also. They wanted halal certificate. They would ensure, because halal certificate basically that is that is a religious standard, and some Muslim that is legalized by the consultation of usually required, that is Islamic law. And some Islamic person, they came to our factory and they will inspect whether you are maintaining all the things or not according to halal. So they will issue the halal certificate for anything, for any food product. If we want to send to our UAE country, then they would wanted this halal certificate. And like if we talking about our Europe countries, then they don't want halal certification. They wanted kosher certification, because kosher certification is a Jewish standard. Like this halal is basically accordance of the Islamic law, and kosher is just like a Jewish right? So for the European and USA, we need this kosher certificate, and for the UAE, we need the halal certificate. And one more document, that is a health certificate. The shipment of live animal and animal product, if we are sending some product, some meat product and fish product and some dairy product, then our health certificate also required, and that is basically given by our agriculture and animal and plant health inspection services are there. They are issuing and they are authorized to give us health certificate. That is one more thing, that is ingredient certificate. You can say ki this can be a form of dossier form also. You can say ki bhi, what are the ingredients we had used into that. In all criteria, we have to give them all product content, what percentage and which chemical data, what are the microbiological standard, what are the storage instruction. This is all should be in green certificates. We have to give them the ingredient certificate. And then we have to inspection certificate. If sometimes they wanted our rice and the grains are mostly sent to the Iran, Iraq. They also defined certain labs also. Certain lab and certain certification body, they had given the authorization. This is a third party inspection. So it means sometime our customer also, they wanted in USA, mostly NSF. NSF, they had authorized the NSF for the third party as a, and in for Iran, Iraq, they have Intratech, they had given some permission for this SGS certification body. They had given this type of independent inspection inspection certificate may required in some instance. They don't want ISO 22000 and other certification, because they wanted their own third party, because they had validated their inspection criteria, and they had pointed out ki from this company they can list out 3-4 companies, we need this inspection certificate from either Intratech or SGS. They had a variety of, they had channelized a variety of the laboratories name and our certification bodies. Sometimes they has also pre-shipment instruction. The government of a number of the countries have contracted with international inspection companies to verify the quality. Even our government also, and our customer also, they wanted some pre-shipment inspection. What are the requirements for pre-shipment? Inspections are normally spelled out in letter of credit, or you can say that is an Intratech, that can be, you can say bank guarantee or LC. Okay. So only, in earlier slide also, I had told you ki they also required, they had specified some third party inspection companies also. So for pre-shipment, pre-shipment inspection before sending to the shipment to our port, that is much required. And along with that, we also need for insurance certificate. Basically, insurance certificates are used to assure the consignee that insurance will cover the loss of any damage of the cargo during transit. And that is basically for the safety aspect. Because customer, they had paid us and they had given us the LC, or again LC, whenever they will take the product, then we can open the LC, and that LC against bank will release our payment. So then if any problem or any damage in the transit, then we need this insurance certificate. Then sometime sanitary certificate also in some countries they also want, like sanitary certificate now is a requirement for Nepal also, because that is a very very small country. Now they wanted for this sanitary certificate, or that is also they had given a few list of the laboratories, those who are eligible to send the sanitary certificate. All shipment of fresh fruit and vegetables, seeds, nuts, fruits, rice, grains, they are basically, the certificate must verify that the product is free from specified epidemic or agriculture disease. There is no disease basically. That is a sanitary certificate. and that is given by the our agriculture department and animal and plant health inspection services. That is, I think, for the North India, there are agencies, few agencies in Delhi. So they are giving this sanitary certificate. Then in some area also, they want some radiation certificate. Some countries, including Saudi Arabia, may require this certificate for some plant and animal animal import. The certificate states that products are not contaminated by radioactivity, because sometimes we are using the harmful chemicals on that meat in this, on the meat, and any antibiotic in very mass chapter, then we need this radiation certificate ki we had not uses more than that ratio of the radiation, and that is given by the agencies. And others product specific certificate, even sometime also for the milk and milk products, they wanted EIC inspection is also there. EIC basically Export International Council is there. They will come, and they will inspect, and they will give you the report, and they are giving the certificate for particular period, and every year they will come to the inspection and they will issue the report. So sometimes they also some specified product specific certificate they also wanted, and some weight certificate also. In certificate of weight is document issued by the custom, certify gross weight of the exported product, that is given by the our custom department. Then registration cum membership certificate, that is also is one document. Export should seriously consider having the freight forwarder handle the probable amount of the documentation that export required. Freight forwarder and specialize in this process. There are few companies also, those who can also this registration cum membership certificate, and even some shipment agency also can do. Whether like a PIDA also, we have to take some time for grains. Like if we talk about the rice, there are the right two type of rice we are exporting. One is the basmati and second one is the non-basmati. For especially for the basmati, they wanted a PIDA certificate, because a PIDA is the agency which also ensure for the food products. And other food certificate also required by our customer. They wanted sometime ISO 22000, ISO 9001. Even in the few countries like Australia, they wanted FSSC, like GFSI equivalent standard they wanted. For if we want to send our product in UK, they wanted BRC. These are the few that is, it depend again according to country to country what they have specified. For particular USA, they also wanted few of the countries, they wanted this GFSI standards like BRC, FSSC standard. So BRC is particular for the UK, and they have a certain parameter what should be the. Now they had even sometime our importer also given us the instruction ki what should be the label claimed also. So we have to follow as per our FSSI for the domestic purpose, but for exporting purpose, we need to follow their company regulations, their country specification. In USA instead of certificate of origin, they require GSP certificate. That is a generalized system preferences. Like earlier I said, ki certificate of origin mostly people they wanted, like in UK. UK and Middle East companies, they wanted a certificate of origin, but especially in the USA, they wanted this GSP certificate, and they also wanted US FDA certificate. They strictly because here we are sending the honey is a most famous product which we are exporting, and they wanted US FDA. So again, this is a sort of certification. There are the certain people, they are authorized to do this US FDA inspection. So they will come inspection, and they will insist in they will ensure for the US FDA, and they will issue the certificate. In European country, it provide European norms. They have a certain different norms, can like sometime they wanted EU GMP is especially for the European countries. And for lab testing, they also specify some inspection agency. They had authorized, they have a certain list of authorized agencies. Whenever step one, these are the things that in previous slide, we had given you the, these are the things required. And first of all, whenever any query we received, whenever we need, we have to specify what is the export transition is an inquiry. We need what size and standard and what drawings. What drawings, but sometimes they also giving us some specific container size also they wanted. And sometimes they also want some sample. You just send us the sample. Please mute yourself. I think some problem is there. Please mute. And sample sometime our importer. Please, I am disturbing. Please mute yourself. They sometime our customer, they also wanted some sample before before going to the this order. They wanted some sample. So we have to get ready for the sample and the quantity required. We have to also go through with the quantity which is required and what is the delivery schedule. Suppose they had given us the 100 tons and what will be the delivery schedule. We have to focus also in MOU also, because in MOU we have to specify all the things, because if we are bypass the MOU, so then it is it can basically business to as well as us and as well as our customer also in vice versa. Is any price required by FBO and CFA and CIFA basis? Basically, all should be fixed in our MOU. What will be the FBO charges and what are the CNFA and what is the transit cost? We have to declare all these things. Mode of dispatch, whether they wanted through sea or air, whatever, because that depend on, because if we are sending our product through air, then it will be little higher charges for the transit. For the sea, it is delay, but cost is less. Then mode of packing, in which packing they wanted, suppose they wanted some gunny bag and they wanted some containers. This all we have to ensure for the mode of packing. And terms of payment, because that is a very much important terminology, because if we are fulfilling all the thing, but payment terms, if we are not fixing, what is the LC terms and condition and letter of credit, anything, whatever the requirement, that should be ensured. You have to ensure that also. Is there any requirement of pre-shipment inspection? You have to ask whether any pre-shipment inspection you needed. Sometime they don't want, and sometime they also give this inspection companies we required some certification from this companies, whether it can be this BBPI, it can be SGS, it can be Intratech. They have specified the agency. Any certificate of origin required? If so, from that agency. If any certificate they wanted for the certificate of origin, then we have to generate the performer invoice. Because if we have settled down in all MOUA, we have defined each and everything. Price has been defined. Our delivery schedule is defined. Our packing structure is defined. Any certification inspection is defined. Then we will come with the commercial part. That is, step two, we have to generate the performer invoice. What is the basically in that performer, we have to all detail of manufacturer as well as exporter and merchandise exporter will provide a performer invoice to a buyer. It means if we are sending our product to Australia, we have to generate our performer invoice in the name of buyer's name. Then order placement, if the offer is acceptable to buyers in terms of price, delivery and payment term, the buyer will then place an order on the export. they will give us the delivery orders, and you they can also in any kind of letter ki, that is a go through and acceptance letter, you can say that is a that kind of order acceptance. It is advisable ki, before exporting anything you have to ensure ki they had given us the order acceptance, right? Because whenever we have sent the in a performer invoice, we have to give all detail in which media we have to send our product, which agency is there, each and every aspect should be covered in the performer invoice. After that, we need for the order acceptance from our customers, right? And that is a very important subject. Sometime customer they are not issuing order acceptance, and when we are sending the products and they are not taking the product, and they are buy back our products. Sometime our industry they are focusing on that also. The order acceptance that should be must there, and there is good goods readiness and documentation. Where once the goods are ready, duly packed in export, but as according to depending of the mode of the dispatch, and our invoice is prepared by the exporter. If the number of packages more than one, a packing list is a must. So then, if you are sending one packed, so then I think in few countries they bypass that. But if we are more than one packages are there, then the packing list is must with every packaging. Even if the goods to be exported are excisable, non-excisable, because in some time our product in few in you can say in few area, even our government they had given us the opportunity ki there is excise duty should be exempted, and no GST should be there, and this all should be we have to clear with the our customers. Good removal from the box. There are different procedure for removing export consignment to the port following the this like AR4, but it would be advisable to get the consignee seal the central excise authority at the factory premises. But in every aspect we don't call the central excise authorities, but if we are sending some alcoholic product, like we are sending some beverages, then the central excise authorities they will come to our factories, and they will also inspect as a custom authorities at port can be avoided. So we will ensure ki whether we are sending, because if our product is already excisable product, and if any inspection should be there by the central excise authority, so if we avoid that, so sometime while on the custom authorities, they had given us the objection list, and they are the huge charges we have to bear. If export consignments are removed from the factory of manufacturer following of AR4 procedure claiming exempt of excise duty, there is no obligation cast to importer to the provide proof of export to the central expert. As I told, if we are sending some product which is under the excise department, then we need to inspection of the central excise authority, like especially for the beverages cases. But if we don't require for this, so we can also exempt you to that. And what other document like C&FA, that is a clearing and forwarding agent, we are called as a C&FA agent. The exporter is expected to provide the following document to the clearing and forwarding agent, which is also sometime nominated by the customers. And what they want, basically, first of all, they wanted invoice, their packing list, declaration in form SDF to meet the requirement as a FERA in duplicate, AR4 first and second copy, any other declaration as required by custom, which whatever other documents they wanted by the customs, we have to provide to the C&FA agent. Like if we have a 100% export facility, then we have to declare to the export agency ki we have a 100% EOA industry, because when we are declaring ki we are 100% EOA, so then our government they are giving us some benefit, and they are bypass our charges, even they can also we can also claim the drawback facility. Like this is the thing basically which we wanted. And after the customer clearance, because that is one of the major aspect for the custom clearance when we are sending our product. After assessment of the shipping bill and examination of the cargo by custom when required, the customer consignee are permitted by custom. Basically, custom clearance is a must, and that is given by our CHA on our clearing and forwarding agent. You can call as a CHA or custom clearance agency. We have to declare and we should have this custom clearance system. So that is again done by the on the port, and if we are sending our product through air, so then only, even if we are sending some product over through road also, so then also again the custom clearance we needed, and that should also again along within our file ki what products we have to send and what custom clearance, the copy of the customer clearance we have to send to our customer as well as we have to retain with us. Then bill negotiation also, then with this authenticated shipping document, the exporter will have to negotiate the relevant export sometime also with the Reserve Bank of India, because this is all whatever we are exporting we have to through our bank, the all detail sent to the Reserve Bank of India, and this is generally given by the banks, and sometime they also want some bank also want you should also intimate to Reserve Bank, and this we have to follow. This is I think which I had shared the knowledge, and now I will ask to sir ki you just also share your thoughts. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes madam, yes sir.
Yeah, please you. Please. Yeah.
Thank you very much, madam. Before passing on the session to Prem Kumar, I request the participants, if you have any queries regarding Poonamji's ideas and thought process which she has shared it to all of us now, we can discuss and.
Yes, Ram Kumar, actually. Mr. Mohammed Ali is having one question. Poonam?
Yes, sir.
He is asking the question.
Yeah.
Export food receipt. What are all to check as per guidelines? Please inform.
Export checklist?
Export food receipt.
Because this is all declaration by in MOU. While we are... signed a MOU, that is a memorandum of understanding, we have to share each and everything. Basically, that should be there along with the shipment. Sometime we required to send to our bank also. This is our MOU, and through this all parameter we have to follow this in MOU.
Okay, Poonam, this is, I can communicate to Mr. Mohammed. Mohammed, is it okay for you? Please type in chat box. Mr. Mohammed? Okay, fine.
He is not there.
No more questions in this side.
Yeah.
Now I am unmuting all the people. Those who are having questions to talk, please feel free to ask with Poonam Gupta madam. She will have some time to answer her queries. Please. Anybody have any questions? Mr. Yogesh Jain sir, any question from your side?
You can say ki all clear, matlab it is over from the head or it is all clear?
All clear.
We all clear. Thank you. Matlab that should not be beyond our head, because that clearance we don't want basically. Because this COVID time, na, that is a very critical time. we have to conscious about this while we are exporting to the food also, because already so many people, they are import export few products, and we have to get ensure while we are importing and exporting the food products, right? I mean, even now a time we have to taken care about the shelf life also, because in every country they wanted the what is the transit time. After that they will retain with the 14 days quarantine period also there. It means our shelf life should be more than that period. If I am sending my product to UAE and their transit time is approximately 5 days, and 5 days plus 14 days that is required by the, it means we have to ensure for the shelf life of our product. And we should, whenever we are sending our product, so we should avoid with the pesticide, because in some containers container people they are not segregated our product from any other chemically products. So it means the both products should be separately should be fixed up, because sometimes color and sometimes even fragrance also can impact on that. So in this COVID time we have to more into that, and for the food products also. Any other question? Any other experience if you are exporting something? Anybody want to share their experience? Hello.
Now I'm unmuting all. Or please chat if you need to. Please give message in the chat box. I will unmute and you can talk. Fine. Mr. Mohammed asking the question, how we check halal certificate in export items?
Which one?
Mr. Mohammed Ali is asking the question.
Yeah.
How we check halal certificate in export items?
Halal certificate?
Yeah.
Halal certificate, that is basically how we check halal certificate in export items. Basically, that is a one, there are the certain agencies, those who are authorized to give the halal certification. Because if we talked about for the UAE, they say Halal India is a major company. They are issuing the halal certificate. But in few area, some Norway, I forgotten the country name. They don't want, even they don't want accept this Halal India certificate. They have a different agencies and they will send from their country. You have to ensure with the customer before sending any material.
Yeah, one more question from Mr. Dr. K.
Yeah.
Is PCQA in the companies exporting, or can we get a consultant to do it mandatory?
No. Every company they can do theirself. You don't require. You require only CHA and your clearing and forwarding agency. You need to hire, because on the custom department. How we have to submit all documentation.
Actually, Ms. Dr. K, basically is for the purpose of FSMA, Food Safety Modernization Act from USFDA.
Yeah.
It is not a mandatory certification. It's not a certification. It is a requirement for goods exporting to USFDA. PCQA is a qualification for the person who is working for this FSMA in our organization. But anytime in terms of USFDA license, it is an obligatory requirement.
Yeah, obligatory. But in FOSS, especially, I had visited approximately 6-7 years back. I had visited Malir Kotla. There is a place in Malir Kotla, and that is a big hub for this bee exporting. They are sending their honey to USA. So they had deputed some agency. Those were given. They just verify basically all the certification. They will ensure for the your hygienic and hygienic conditions, and what are the equipments you are using, they are ensuring. And USFDA people, they had nominated some auditor. They had inspected to that company, and they had issued the certificate, USFDA certificate, to that company name, not the person name. That is basically that, because person can be changed, but your hygienic system and your equipment, it cannot be changed. Person can be changed. So it means USFDA. USFDA basically, they are giving to the company name.
One more question. People asking, halal is for only veg or non-veg product. Halal is for both veg and non-veg product is applicable. It is not relevant for the, not only relevant for non-veg. Non-veg, it is used from traditional way, but halal is common for all kind of food chain activities. Even hospitals can go for halal. Schools can go for halal.
Yeah. Even sometimes...
Halal is only for non-veg. It is applicable for vegetarian food also.
Yes. Absolutely right. I'm agree with you. Because in sometime people also ask for the, if you are sending some jadi buti type products, they also sometimes they require the halal certification. And we also approach to the halal authorities. They will give us the certificate ki whether we are complying with it. They will come. Any person, they then only Muslim person, they just repute to the that area ki you have to ensure that ki whether what system they are adopting. So they will also given the certificate to those who are into the jadi buti and the plants also. So now it's applicable. I am very much agree with you ki halal is not only for the non-veg, that is also non-veg or veg, both material.
And Ms. Panam, I think we are closing with all the doubts and clarification of the audience.
Dinesh Chaudhary, they had raised one question: is FSMS certification mandatory for food handler, hotel, restaurant? What certification required for slaughterhouse? That is again, first of all, Mr. Dinesh, I had taken from your chat. That is one question. Which is mandatory requirement, that is for the FSSI. First of all, we have complied with the our country regulation, that is the FSSI requirements we have to comply. And one thing more which is given by the FSSI, they had given us FOSTECH certificate ki upon 25% there must be one food safety supervisor must be there. And for FSMS certification is not mandatory for every food handlers. That is a willingness standards, because they are not, and sometime your customer also, and sometime also an hotel can apply for the kosher as well as the halal certification. Ki on which type of meat they are using. Because one of my customers, they came to Afghanistan, and he's a Muslim, and they don't want to go in any hotel. They wanted only halal, where they are getting this halal meat. So in bigger city, you can see also ki halal certification is applicable on the restaurants also.
I think time up. Let us have to close the session. So whenever people need some clarification, let them contact through your mailbox or other communication media. Okay.
Yeah.
It's really wonderful session, Ms. Panam. People have got more information on these export-oriented products and its requirements. Yeah. Thank you so much to all.
Thank you.
Hello.
Haji, yes.
Ma'am, can you please share some details on how we can this just export this raw material, for example, like this lemon.
Like this?
Like lemon.
Lemon. First of all, for the importing anything, we have to follow our country regulation, because we have to approach with the FSSI. While we are taking some product, we need the FBO manufactured details.
Ma'am, I want to know about. Hello.
Hello. Yeah, Mr. Harith.
Yeah, I want to know about export.
Export or import?
Madam? Export.
Madamji.
Yes, sir.
I think today's time is over. Maybe we can continue the discussion, sir. If you can send your queries to us, we'll pass on to the presenter and the co-presenter, and we'll get the proper answers and solutions for whatever queries you have. So thank you very much, Poonamji and Prem Kumar ji, for conducting this session in a very smooth manner. And today's webinar comes to an end now. And sorry about it that we could not continue the session because of the time constraint. Tomorrow's topic will be production restart, readiness for the food industry post lockdown scenario. So that will be the topic for tomorrow's webinar. So we will all meet in tomorrow's webinar at exactly 5 p.m. Thank you all. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all of you. You had listened for last one hour time. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much to all.